During the 1940s, Walt Disney started experimenting with live-action filmmaking, which included The Reluctant Dragon and Song of the South. But as World War II was coming to an end, Walt found that his studio needed to do more live-action films in order to retain money that they had made in Europe. This birthed a boom in Disney's live-action filmmaking, and it can't be understated how important these films are in the history of Disney. My name's Josh Taylor, this is Modern Mouse, and today we're going to be talking about Disney's live-action films of the 1950s, or as I've dubbed it, Disney's live-action Golden Age. During World War II and the years just slightly after, any profits that were made from a Disney film were kept in both the UK and France. That ensured that any money that was made in those countries stayed in those countries so that Europe could have economic stability. Simply put, Walt Disney had a ton of money sitting in Europe, and the only way that he could get to that money is if he used that money to make films in Europe. On top of this, the British government stated that 45% of films being shown in British theaters should be made in Britain, which only incentivized Disney to make more films there. Building an entire new studio in Europe and sending his animators out there or training new animators in Europe just seemed impractical. So it made sense that they would start making live-action films for Disney. And this is something that Walt Disney had dabbled with in the 1940s. And if you'd like to see more about those movies that I've dubbed the hybrid era of Disney live action, you can see that in my live action eras playlist. So he decided to go full steam ahead with live action filmmaking. And to start off, he decided to pick a story from Robert Louis Stevenson, Treasure Island. Treasure Island began production in 1949, and while Walt had sent a production team to the UK, he and his family weren't far behind, turning a work trip into a vacation. He spent 5 weeks in Europe, with some days being on set. He fell in love with making live-action films and was excited to see the process. The production ran smoothly, with the only worry being that child star Bobby Driscoll, who had been part of Song of the South and so dear to my heart in the era previously, would be unable to work on the film since laws in England prohibited children under 13 from working on set. But that law was just overlooked, and the production went on without any troubles. Walt's enthusiasm bled into the post-production schedule, asking for continuous cuts of the film and having his editor fly back and forth from England to Hollywood so that he could be more hands-on. The Technicolor film would premiere in July of 1950 and would be a major hit for the Disney studio. Made on a budget of $1.8 million, the film would gain over $4 million in its initial run. While the film was getting praise, critics also questioned if we were seeing Walt Disney turning away from animation. He would go on to assure everyone that the studio would still focus on animated films, but it was clear to those at the studio that Walt had fallen in love with live-action filmmaking, and that he would be spending less time with his animators. RKO, Disney's distributor, was pleased with the live-action success, and three more films were greenlit to be shot in England. The story of Robin Hood and his Merry Men would hit theaters in 1952 and would be another major success, making $4.5 million at the box office. For Robin Hood, Walt Disney hired Ken Annakin to direct and Irish actor Richard Todd to play the title role. Ken Annakin would fly out to California to turn storyboards from the studio into scripts. And with the film's success, Disney took the entire team and put them into production with the next film, The Sword and the Rose. Based on the 1898 novel, When Knighthood Was in Flower by Charles Major, The Sword and the Rose would once again star Richard Todd and have Anakin directing the film. Unlike the other films that went smoothly in production, The Sword and the Rose saw Richard Todd thrown from a horse, resulting in him being bedridden for nearly a month. The studio where production was happening also went on strike, with the lights just going out during a shoot one day. Maybe this was all foreshadowing for the film's future. Released in 1953 with a budget of $2 million, the film only made $2.5 million in return, which made Walt Disney start to rethink his excitement for the films coming out of England. Rob Roy, the Highland Rogue, began production immediately after The Sword and the Rose, with much of the same cast from the previous film. Richard Todd once again starred as the title character, but due to a conflicting schedule, Ken Anakin was replaced with veteran British director Harold French. Walt Disney gave it a budget of $1.8 million, but once again the film didn't meet expectations. Along with a low-performing box office, Richard Todd was once again injured on set when he was running and stepped into a rabbit hole. Controversy also came with the film as the soldiers portrayed were actual soldiers, and to keep costs down, they were paid a soldier's wage rather than an actor's wage, which was questioned by the British Parliament. At this point, Walt Disney admitted defeat and declared that he was done, at least for the time being, with giant costumed historic pieces. And now no longer having to make trips back and forth to England since the money from World War II had been spent, the focus could now shift to the Burbank studio in California. And his first major fully live-action production out of the studio was 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. It's also of note that right at this time, Disney stopped working with RKO Productions as its distributor. Rather than continuing to pay a middleman, Disney created Buena Vista Pictures as its sole distribution arm. This allowed the company to keep more of the money made at the theaters and was a revolution at the Walt Disney Company. Buena Vista Pictures would go on to be the distributor for all kinds of other studios that have now become subsidiaries of Disney, but we'll get to that later. Okay, back to 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Disney already had two giant sound stages on their lot, thanks to productions on television series like Disneyland. And it was used as space for live actors to be drawn by animators. So 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea was brought on with a budget of $5 million to be made entirely at the studio. A big leap forward in budget from the films made in the UK, Disney wanted big stars to be attached to the film. James Mason was a major star in both the UK and the US, acting in films like the original A Star Is Born opposite Judy Garland. He was cast in the lead role of Captain Nemo. Character actor Peter Lorre was also cast, being most notable for his roles in The Maltese Falcon and Casablanca. And probably the most famous and notable of the cast is Kirk Douglas as Ned Land, a more lighthearted role complete with its own song for a serious actor, who already had a notable filmography at the time, but would go on to even bigger success in movies like Spartacus and Lust for Life, where he'd be nominated for a Best Actor Oscar for playing Vincent van Gogh. For a director, Walt brought in Richard Fleischer after seeing his successful film The Happy Time. It's actually an odd choice since Richard was the son of Max Fleischer, a rival animator famous for Popeye and Betty Boop cartoons during the 1930s. Unfortunately for the production, costs soared from the $5 million budget to $9 million when they realized that the two sound stages that Disney had weren't actually equipped for the giant scenes they were looking to create. Sound stages at both 20th Century Fox and Universal Studios had to be rented out to complete some scenes. Certain shots of the production were actually moved to the Bahamas and Jamaica, and a third, much larger soundstage had to be built at the Disney Studios to house a giant water tank. This soundstage would be used for the iconic scene of the squid attacking the Nautilus submarine. Speaking of the Nautilus submarine, it was designed by Harper Goff, who, along with Peter Ellenshaw, worked on the production design of the film. Originally, Walt wanted something sleek and simple, but Harper Goff convinced him that the ship would be made out of parts Nemo would find, and Goff was right. The Nautilus would end up having an iconic look that would stand the test of time and help cement it as a signature Jules Verne steampunk ship. I brought up Peter Ellenshaw as well because he was somebody that Walt trusted. He was actually hired to work on Treasure Island, and Walt Disney liked that so much that he kept him on for all of the British films and eventually brought him over to the US to work on 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. He would become the studio's production designer and special effects guy throughout the rest of the 1950s and into the 1960s. In total, he worked on over 30 of Disney's live-action productions, helping stylize and elevate them above what the rest of Hollywood was making at that time. The film would go on to gross $28 million in 1954 and its future re-releases, paying off the high, overly budgeted production. The film would also get acknowledged for its special effects and production design at the Academy Awards, and sets were actually repurposed for a walkthrough exhibit in the newly opened Disneyland in 1955, making sure that the lineage of the film would last for years, or at least until the walkthrough was taken down in 1966, but the legacy continued on through the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea attraction at Orlando's Magic Kingdom, again until that attraction was then closed. The success of 20,000 Leagues also coincided with the success Disney was having on television. Every week, Walt Disney was producing a special for TV. The Disneyland TV show would feature updates and behind-the-scenes looks at films in production, made-for-TV versions of his films, a look at the new theme park, or original creations made just for TV, which spawned a craze around frontiersman Davy Crockett. The original three episodes in a miniseries, each an hour long, were edited down into one long movie. Davy Crockett, King of the Wild Frontier, would hit theaters in 1955. Merchandise flew off the shelves, including toy rifles and coonskin hats. In total, Disney sold over $300 million in merchandise before the craze died down. To keep the craze going, another series for TV, which would be turned into a film, would be made and released in 1956, called Davy Crockett and the River Pirates. The stars of the show would also go on tour across North America, Europe, and Japan, signing autographs and taking pictures to promote the series and the eventual films. Fess Parker, who played the title character, would be the next contracted star for Disney, and Walt wanted to ride the craze of Davy Crockett and the overall popularity of Westerns in Hollywood. So Parker became the Western star at Disney Studio. He'd play major roles in films like Westward Ho, The Wagons, The Great Locomotive Chase, and The Light in the Forest. His biggest role outside of Davy Crockett would come in 1957, playing the father role of Jim Coates in the movie Old Yeller. Old Yeller was based on the novel by Fred Gibson, who believed that most modern children's books had become too soft, and he wanted to create a story based in realism. Before the book was even released to the public, Disney bought the film rights and hired Fred Gibson to start writing the script for the film. Not much was actually changed from the book, other than a mule replacing a bull in a certain scene, and that was because nobody wanted to get seriously injured, and even though the mule scene was difficult to shoot, nobody died. As far as other castings in this movie, Dorothy McGuire would be hired to play the role of the mother, Katie Coates, and for the younger roles of the family, Mickey Mouse Club stars Tommy Kirk and Kevin Corcoran, better known as Moochie on the Mickey Mouse Club, were cast. Previously, Disney had hired British-born Robert Stevenson to direct the film Johnny Tremaine, a story of a young man in Boston prior to the American Revolution. And after the success of Johnny Tremaine, Stevenson became a staple at Disney, working on films all the way into the mid-1970s. His next project after Johnny Tremaine would be Old Yeller, a notable entry in his filmography, but definitely not his last major directing gig. When it came to the ending of Old Yeller, many at the studio felt it should be changed to create a happier, Disney-like ending. But Walt insisted that the story's ending, of young Travis Coates having to put down his companion Old Yeller, was compelling and moving. The gamble to make a film with a not-so-happily-ever-after ending paid off. Several premieres were held all around the United States, with some even allowing dog owners to bring their dogs to the theater to watch it with them. A gimmick that I'm sure got newspapers and TV news programs buzzing about the film, because it was another outstanding success, grossing over $21 million at the box office. Disney's film success was starting to become varied, Dramas like Old Yeller or giant epics like 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea would go right along with his animated stories. But there was something that they still hadn't tried, a flat-out comedy. So they made one in 1959 with The Shaggy Dog. When Walt Disney purchased the rights to Felix Salten's 1923 story Bambi, he actually bought several other stories by Salten, including one called The Hound of Florence. Originally thought up to be a short cartoon before he tried to pitch it to ABC for a new television series. But when they turned him down, he opted to turn it into a full-length feature. He turned to his Mickey Mouse Club cast, once again bringing on Tommy Kirk to play the lead of Wilby Daniels, a boy who turns into a sheepdog. Kevin Corcoran was brought in to play the younger brother, as well as Mickey Mouse Clubbers Tim Coneside and Annette Funicello, who had been the Mickey Mouse Club's standout star. Comedy actor Fred McMurray and Singin' in the Rain star Gene Hagen were brought in as the parental figures of the film. And Mickey Mouse Club director Charles Barton would move over to this production. Disney claimed that the movie was made for around $1 million and was really produced under the radar. Nobody, even at the Disney studio lot, really paid any attention to the little comedy film that was being made. The movie was shot inexpensively and quickly. The script was even being rewritten as the film was shot. This allowed them to write dialogue for the dog's mouth movements to make it seem more realistic. I guess as realistic as a dog talking can be. The Shaggy Dog would go on to make $9 million at the box office in its first run, making it the second highest grossing film of 1959, and the most profitable live-action film that Disney had made to date. The success of The Shaggy Dog created a new formula for Disney, using television stars in their off-season during summer breaks, and setting these stories in modern times to keep the costs low. Creating comedic stories about situational or supernatural events was fun for the whole family, and what we know about Disney is that he wanted to be fun for the whole family. The Shaggy Dog might not be the film that you think of as a standout production from the 1950s from Disney, but it's the film that became a guiding light for the next few decades. And it allowed Disney to ramp up production, making films for cheaper and making more films each year. Another way to keep costs low was to repackage miniseries from television. Like Davy Crockett before, Zorro had become a household name thanks to the TV show of the same name. The movies The Sign of Zorro and Zorro the Avenger were actually made for release outside of the US, allowing for the character to become a worldwide phenomenon since the TV show only aired in America. Children loved the character, and the character was so popular that many students could be seen carving the letter Z into their desks. Problematic, but hey, it was a success. Following on the formula from The Shaggy Dog, though, Pollyanna would be a cheap production from Disney. Animator David Swift was brought on to produce, write, and direct the film. Young actor Haley Mills was cast in the lead role. The film would end up underperforming at the box office, but its big takeaway was star Haley Mills, who would go on to be one of Disney's new contracted stars for several years. The film also became a cult classic in the years that followed, garnering more attention in theatrical re-releases and on home video, and it's now seen by critics and film lovers as one of the highlights of this live-action golden era. Rounding out the Disney live-action golden era is one of its biggest successes, The Swiss Family Robinson. And this film had a ton of people working on it that we've already talked about. Disney had really created a family of cast and crew tightly connected to the studio. Director Ken Annakin, who had worked on several of the British films from the early 1950s, as well as the movie Third Man on the Mountain, an adventure film that would inspire Disneyland's Matterhorn Mountain attraction, would sign on to direct Disney's version of the classic Johann David Weiss novel. Tommy Kirk and Kevin Corcoran would once again play siblings. Dorothy McGuire, who had been the mother in Old Yeller, would play the motherly role here, and famous British actor John Mills, the father of Haley Mills, was cast as the patriarch of the Robinson family. James MacArthur of Hawaii Five-O fame and Janet Munro, who had previously starred in Disney's Darby O'Gill and the Little People, as well as Third Man on the Mountain, would also be part of this cast. Something that not a lot of people talk about, but it's definitely worth noting, is that all of Disney's productions up to Swiss Family Robinson, and including many films in the future, were made with all white casts. But Hollywood wasn't just made up of only white actors. There were plenty of people of color in Hollywood, and the Swiss Family Robinson brought on one of, if not the most famous Asian actor in all of the early 20th century. Sisu Hayakawa got his start in film during the silent era of movies, but as films transitioned into sound, he became a major actor in both Japan and in America. His most notable role in Hollywood was as Colonel Sato in The Bridge on the River Kwai. Him being cast as the pirate Koala in Swiss Family Robinson is a big deal and should be celebrated more than it is. He's honestly not an actor enough people talk about, and this is a situation that seems representative of current times, so I thought I'd bring it up here. The movie was shot over the course of 6 months in Tobago, with a real treehouse being built on the island. The production was no paradise. Due to the foliage and treehouse placement, shadows were cast during most of the day. The crew only had around 3 hours to get what they needed every day, meaning that they always had to work fast. Another problem is that the island didn't have any native animals. That meant that when the production on the island was finished, an identical set had to be built on a sound stage at the studio, so that they could bring in animals to act alongside the actors. Released in 1960, Disney's take on the classic novel brought in drama and comedy to the epic tale. It received favorable reviews and would make $8 million in its initial run and would later gross over $40 million in re-releases. Swiss Family Robinson really feels like a true climax to all of the hard work being done at Disney Studio, thanks to the cast and crews that had really owned their crafts in drama, comedy, and action-adventure films. These folks laid the groundwork for what would become a major division at Disney, and they created a roadmap for future films for years to come. Of course, not every film was a major success, and we didn't talk about every single film from this era, and we definitely won't talk about every single film from future eras since there's a lot of them and I only have so much time. But the true successes that Disney did have from this era would have those films translate to TV specials or to theme park attractions at the Disneyland and eventual other resorts around the world. What had originally started out as Walt Disney being forced to use money in Europe and make live-action films that way had really become a major arm of the Walt Disney Studio, helping the studio grow faster and stronger than it ever had when it was just an animation department. But we're still not done with Disney's live-action golden era, because outside of the scripted films that Disney had made, he was also interested in documentaries. And he would go on to create an entirely new genre that we're all familiar with. Nature documentaries started as part of his television and short film repertoire before he made 7 feature films during this golden age of live action. These films were nicknamed the True Life Adventures, and they'll be something that we take a deep dive into in the next installment in this live action series. If you're interested in hearing more about Disney's live-action eras, including an overview of the entire thing in the 1940s and so on, I suggest clicking the playlist that's come up. And if you're interested in knowing more about Disney's animation eras, there's a playlist for that too. If you enjoyed this video, I would love it if you gave it a like, if you shared it around on social media or with friends and family. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, what are you waiting for? Do so now. In the meantime, thank you, my friends, and as always, keep moving forward.